return to you. Oh, mystery, undying yearning to you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come everywhere among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come every way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna. Lift your head, weary sinner. The river's just ahead. Down the path of forgiveness, salvation's waiting there. You build a mighty fortress, 10,000 burdens high. Love's here to lift you up, it's here to lift you high. If you're lost, like a prodigal child, see the wall star crumbling. Let the gates of glory open wide. All who strayed and walked away, unspeakable things you've done. Fix your eyes on the mountain, let the past be dead and gone. Come on, saints and sinners, you can't outrun. come, power of the blood. If you're lost and wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. If you're lost and wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide.
Oh, the overwhelming, never. Oh, come to
the altar. Your Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Your Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. No one to save you. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him. For he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Might go 15 because we're going to stop and pray for the Ukrainians as a part of the message today. A former space engineer and Bible student predicted the second coming of Jesus would happen in 1988. He actually published a booklet, 88 Reasons Why the Rapture Would Take Place in 1988. He gave away 300,000 copies, but then sold over 4.5 million of this booklet. When it didn't happen, he wrote another booklet titled On Borrowed Time with a new date. And when that date was wrong, he wrote another one, and another one, and another one. Each time, it would sell fewer copies, but he had done found a little cash cow for himself. The religion writer at that time called me up and asked me about that first publication. 88 Reasons Why Jesus Is Coming Back in 1988. And I told her, well, he can cite 88 reasons why Jesus may be coming back in 1988. I'll just give you one that says, no man knows the day or the time that Jesus is going to return. That's found in Matthew 24:36. Now concerning the day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son of God. The Father alone knows the day and time that He is going to rapture us home and we will experience the second coming and the end times. It goes on to say, and we'll read these scriptures together. Before we read them, we'll pray and ask God to help us understand them. Father, we thank You for Your holy word, which is where we find truth, which is where we find truth to stand on, to live our lives, and to trust the daily lives, and also trust our eternity. Help us now to understand and apply. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew 24:36-51. But about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in a field. One will be taken, the other one left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken and the other one left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect Him. Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them their food at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. Truly I tell you, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose that servant is wicked and says to himself, my master is staying away a long time. And he then begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with drunkards. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Strong words for the end of times. Strong words for stewardship of what God has charged us with. Our lives, our time, our talents, all those resources. Even though we don't know the exact day and hour, we do know it could be any day, any hour. And if the author of the book had been correct, he wouldn't have predicted it. He would have guessed it. He would have guessed right. But he didn't. Ponder this. Why doesn't God want us to know the day or hour? Why doesn't He want us to know the exact time? It could be, if we knew the precise day and hour, we might be tempted to procrastinate. We might be tempted to procrastinate and become lazy, doing the Lord's work He has assigned to do only at the last moment. which is to populate the earth, be good stewards of the earth and our time and talents, and also to be the hands and feet and voice of Jesus. That is, not being selfish, but being unselfish with all that God has given us and being a good steward of those things that He has charged us with. When we are the hands and feet and voice of Jesus, what are we? What are we to be doing? We're to be studying and living and teaching God's Word. We are to be caring for widows and orphans. We are to be working to care for our families and the poor. We are to be sharing the good news of forgiveness and salvation. We are to be sharing from what God has given us. I found a movie recently. I believe it's on Amazon. And the name of it is Mully. If you get a chance, no, not if you get a chance, take the time to see that movie. It was a man born in Kenya. He was born into a house with several other siblings. His father was a drunkard, and his father beat his mother. One day, this young boy woke up. When he woke up, everyone was gone from his family. He was the only one in the little house, the little hut that he lived in, all alone, almost like a rapture. He walked around, and he ended up at his uncle's house, which was very close by, and he was hungry, and his uncle shooed him away with a stick. He started walking, and he started begging, and he begged for years and years and years. And he learned to beg, and he learned that would be the only way that he could survive. He ended up being invited to go to a worship center, to go to a church. And on that day, the pastor gave a message of hope and a message of God will give you a dream. And with that, he was so inspired. One might even read into it. He had a salvation experience. And he began to walk to Nairobi, the biggest city. And when he gets to Nairobi, again, he's walking door to door. People shooing him away. Finally, he ended up at the house of a lady of Indian religion. And she finally said, "You can come in and you can wash my floors. You can wash my dishes." She basically hired him as a servant. And he ate the food off the plates of what he was washing. But he was thrilled. He was thrilled. Could you imagine us being thrilled with getting to wash dishes at a restaurant and eating the food that was left over on the plates? That may seem foreign to us, but if you're hungry, we would be thrilled to do that. Well, he was such a good worker that the husband of the lady that hired him put him in a very prominent position where he was a supervisor over many in the fields. I'm going to not tell you the whole story. I will just get closer to the end. He became very wealthy. He had a taxi service. He became very wealthy. He had the joy of the Lord in his heart. He would play music. He would play this movie is dated a little bit, but he would play things that we might be Don Williams and Patsy Cline and just different stars you wouldn't think that people in Nairobi would enjoy, but they enjoy anything from the West. He had some beautiful children. He married one of the workers in the field. They had beautiful children, very articulated. He had them educated. And they're a part of this documentary movie that you get to see. But when he got on in life, God gave him a vision to sell everything that he had and to pull kids off the street. He literally would get in his car at night, go to a street where there's just street kids, by the thousands, with no parents, No law, no order, just street kids. And he'd go pick one out or more. And he started bringing them back to his house. His wife and children did not understand what he was doing. People in the community thought he was crazy. Even the local church, when he took his new children with him to church, they voted to ban him from the church. But he didn't quit. He knew that he didn't own anything, that God owns everything. And he used all his resources to save children off the street. I'll let you watch the movie. You will be astounded at the number of children. At the time of the documentary, there were 25,000 children that had been pulled off the street by his arms into his family. And he's not. And they call him Daddy Mully. Everybody calls him Daddy Mully. And his children that didn't understand, his wife that didn't understand, they bought in. And now it's a family operation. It's a family ministry where they're taking the resources that God has given them to use for people that are needing and hurting. You know, it could be, if we knew the precise day and hour, we might be tempted to procrastinate. But if we will come to reality, it could be any day, any hour. What difference is that going to make for the way we lived? You see, God's design for the rapture and second coming is swift, sudden, and deliberate. And we need to be living every day like it's our last day spiritually, but planning like we're going to live forever physically. That's how we need to be living our lives. God's will is for us to be good stewards. While we own nothing and God owns everything, He has charged us to care for our domains as we are the owner. We should act as if we're the owner. We should treat it that way, but always acknowledge that God is the owner. We are the caretaker, doing His will, not our will. What if we knew tomorrow was the day and 6 p.m. was the hour? How would we live differently? How would that affect our decisions? Would that affect our decisions? If Miss Martha would hear, I'd start preaching. Because here's the deal. Tomorrow could be today. 4 p.m. could be the hour. Why isn't that changing the way we live? If it's not. If it's not. Life is not easy. In fact, life can be hard. If we knew that Jesus was coming back, let's say at 4 a.m. tomorrow, would we go to bed tonight? I don't believe so. Would we reach out on Facebook or other social media platforms to contact people? Probably. And we'd probably be doing that while we were driving to see others. Or we were driving to go to a church and worship at a church, or to try and see our closest family and friends, or to make amends to people that we had wronged. Or would we find ourselves in a closet hiding and praying, making sure we had things right with God? What would we be doing? When those planes hit us on 9/11, many thought that was the beginning of the end, and Christ would be rapturing us out very soon. I was one of those. I was in China when that happened. I was all alone in a hotel, a very nice, big, fancy, government-owned hotel. But as soon as I heard the news, I thought that this would be the last war. And I began, I immediately felt guilty that I was not here because I had a one-month-old son and my wife and my daughter, that I could not do anything to protect. Our nation became unified and supported and grateful for what we had and who we had. Ironically, or unfortunately, pick any word that you want to fit in there, it was short-lived and soon forgotten. Today, this very moment, Ukrainians, both Christian and non-Christian, are facing something a lot worse. We were hit with a one-shot punch that's purpose was to strike fear, hence the word terror. The Ukrainians are being hit with a complete takeover of their freedom. Let us pause and pray for the people of Ukraine, all the people, those that are Christian, those that are not. And let's also pray for their enemy, Putin, Russia, and those in power that are following Putin and his tyrannical regime. Let's pray for a miracle and pray for the courage for the Ukrainians to fight for right, and to pray for the Russians. Many of them are standing in the gap for the Ukrainians. And just pray that they'll have courage. And for those that are in power, pray they'll have courage to stop doing the wrong things. Let us pray. Father, we pray, and we pray believing, and we pray together. Lord, we pray for the Christians in both Russia and Ukraine and around the world, that they will continue to pray for one another. Lord, we pray for those that are in harm's way, that you'll keep them safe. We pray for those innocent children that are being tossed around and just, Lord, barely enough to survive. We pray for the elderly in those areas too, and pray for those that are in better shape physically, that are being the caregivers for those. We pray that you might just continue to give them. We pray for the humanitarian aid, and that will allow to be continue to be brought in. But Lord, we also pray for the freedom, for what the real battle is over, Lord, for the freedom, and that there would not be control from a foreign nation, from a foreign government, from something that is foreign from democracy. Lord, we pray for a miracle. And Lord, help us to not just pray now, but continue to pray and be persistent in our praying. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Life is not easy for anyone. All families face illnesses. All families face physical, emotional, and even mental type illnesses. All families face uncertainties. Life can actually not just be not easy, but life can be hard if we don't trust God, if we don't let God control our minds and our actions and our hearts, if we don't believe God is God and He will always have the last say. Life can not only be not easy, it can be hard, and it can be sad. But right now, this moment, life is unbearable for the nation and those in Ukraine. It may be hard for us, it may not be easy for us, but right now life is just unbearable for the people of the nation of Ukraine, as many are dying as we stand and preach and teach and pray. Life is unbearable as the curtains of democracy and the foundations of democracy, where all are equal in the eyes of God, is being challenged. And we must not forget that Ukraine is just one of those countries on the border that protects our democracy. For this is a small world. It's getting smaller by the day. Let's not forget, with God, with our awareness of His presence, that life is manageable. It may not be easy. It may be hard. It may even be unbearable in our eyes. But with God and awareness of His presence, don't miss that, awareness of His presence that is always with us. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. Last week we talked about the Spirit being given to us, and He said, Jesus said that the Spirit will be with us forever. No matter where we are, what we've done, what we're going through, with God, with our awareness of His presence, life is manageable and rewarding and amazing and victorious. In closing, A year ago, a little more than a year ago, we faced a tough time when the president of our nation was restricted from communicating through various forms of social media. There were reasons cited for that, accusing him of inciting riots, while in reality, he was encouraging the people of the United States to stand up against the forthcoming anti-Christian, politically correct tyranny. Sometimes when we're real close to it, we may not understand. Sometimes even those of us that are living according to God's Word and living according to what is right and believing it and practicing it and talking about it, sometimes we're so close in, we don't see the reality of how anti-God and anti-Scripture and anti-Jew and anti-Christian is straight from the enemy, straight from the pits of hell, and attacking the church and attacking the family and attacking the community. We may not always see that, but we can see that in Ukraine because we can see it from a distance. Make no mistake, that same thing is happening here in our nation. Now, to put that in perspective, media platforms such as YouTube will even allow some of the most horrific information about how to do certain things that will actually allow a person to get high, or allow a person to hurt themselves, or allow a person to cheat someone. Where are the filters on that? You can decide on your own. But here's the deal. The battle is not ours. The battle is God's. Not only do we not own anything, not only are we stewards of what we have been given inside our domain to be a good steward and responsible for, that includes the battle of God. This battle is not ours, it's His. He provides the resources. Only He can win this war against evil. And amazingly and ironically, the most powerful weapon that He has given us as a believer is love. So, we need to be careful that we stand or we not stand on a bully pulpit. We need to be careful that we're not hypocritical, accusing others of being unforgiving and ruthless and selfish with others when we continue to do those things ourselves. Life can be hard. It's not always easy, but it's manageable with God. And He's going to help us manage it today and tomorrow, and He's going to help us manage it until He comes again, and only He knows when that time is. And He has reasons. He has His reasons for only Him to be knowing. But let's live spiritually as if this were the last hour, and live physically as if we were planning to live forever. Let's pray. Father, we love You and we thank You for Your holy word. Lord, we thank You that You have given us a safe place. We thank You for the safe community. We thank You for the safe country. Lord, help us though not stick our head in the sand and not keep up with what is going on. And pray for those that are leaders in our nation, those that are leaders in our community, in our school system. Pray for the leaders in our cities. Let's pray. Help us, Lord, to pray. And help us, Lord, as You inspire those to be a part of government. Lord, I pray that that they'll follow your word and your principles and your guides, just as we are to follow them in our lives. We pray in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. All right, we'll be dismissed today with a blessing. If you stand with me. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Have a wonderful day and a wonderful week.